Maxwell was already convinced that currents in conductors are flows of particles. The discovery of electrons confirmed this intuition of Maxwell. Electric current thus results from the movement of free electrons in a conductor. The rotational magnetic field around the conductor is attributed to this movement of electrons. This displacement must, necessarily, be relative to the fixed atoms in the conductor. The speed of electrons in conductors is supposed today to be a few hundredths of a millimeter per second. Obviously, no magnetic field is produced by moving the conductor. The idea, therefore, came to put the conductor in rotation. Two fundamental experiments then seemed to confirm Maxwell's theory, the Faraday disk and the Rowland disk. Both of these experiments were performed more than a century before it was discovered that electrons have both an angular momentum and an intrinsic magnetic field. However, any rotation causes an alignment effect of the angular momentum with the axis of this rotation. The link between the angular momentum and the intrinsic magnetic field of the electron leads to a totally different interpretation of experiments involving rotations. Moreover, a third experiment, also based on a rotation, completely challenged Maxwell's interpretation of Faraday's and Ampere's experiments. A conductive disk is placed in the magnetic field of a magnet. A brush makes it possible to collect the current at the periphery of the disk. When the magnet rotates, while the conductive disk is stationary, no current is detected in the disk. Faraday thought that the magnet's field, with its flux lines, remained stationary as the magnet rotated. It is true that all field lines are identical. Nothing would therefore modify the behavior of electrons. On the contrary, if the conductive disk rotates, a current flows through it. This paradox surprised Faraday. Nothing seems to change magnetically, and he would expect to see no current. A first explanation was proposed. After the discovery of electrons, the circuit composed of the rotating disk and the brushes constitutes a loop which rotates in the magnetic field of the fixed magnet. As a result, the electrons in the circuit are subjected to the Lorentz force and generate a current. This bold explanation has since been eliminated and replaced by reference frame considerations. The speed involved in the Lorentz force is relative to the reference frame in which the measurements are made in the laboratory, therefore. Consequently, there is indeed a displacement of the electrons in a magnetic field, and therefore a Lorentz force which generates a current perpendicular to the field lines and to the tangential speed of the disk, a radial current therefore collected by the brushes. These explanations of mathematicians take no account of the fact that electrons have an angular momentum. In reality, when the conductor rotates, the spins of the electrons statistically align in the axis of rotation, and so the orientation of their magnetic field changes. It is precisely this orientation that corresponds to a current in the circuit of the disk. Rowland's experiment is usually presented simplistically by a compass being deflected by a rotating electrically charged disk. The reality is much more complex. There is only a magnetic field near the edge of the disk as seen in this photograph. Rowland used a sort of circular capacitor. A rotating conductive disk, positively charged, was placed between the negative plates of the capacitor. Two compasses hang from a thread. The lower one is placed on the edge of the rotating disk. The small deviation, resulting from the magnetic field, is detected by a mirror attached to the wire. The rotational magnetic field, at a point on the disc, is the integral of the fields of the loops traveled, from the axis of the disc to the edge of the disc. It is therefore maximum at the edge of the disc. Within the framework of Maxwell's theory, this rotational magnetic field has a component in the plane of the disc, if it is measured above the disc, or in a plane perpendicular to the disc, if it is measured on the edge of the disc. Maxwell's theory ignores the fact that electrons have angular momentum. In reality, when the disc rotates, the spins of the electrons statistically align with the axis of rotation. And so the orientation of their magnetic field changes. It is precisely this orientation that is the cause of the magnetic field. In Rowland's experiment, the magnetic field observed at the edge of the rotating disc is the sum of the components in the plane of the disc of the rotational intrinsic fields of the rotating electric charges. The rotating conductor carrying more protons than electrons, the observed rotational magnetic field results from the excess protons. In Faraday's experiment, when the magnet rotates and the disc is stationary, the angular moments of the electric charges are not changed. The rotational intrinsic magnetic fields of electric charges cancel each other out, as indeed in the absence of a magnet, nothing happens. But conversely, when the magnet is stationary and the disc rotates, the angular momentum of the electrical charges contained in the conductor aligns statistically in the axis of rotation. The orientation of their intrinsic magnetic field is related to their angular momentum, so it is also changed. But the intrinsic magnetic fields of electrons and nuclei are opposite. Electrons are dissociated from the nuclei and their speed in the field of the magnet submits them to the Lorentz force. There is therefore a current in the disc.